Hello, I'm Chris Flisher, and welcome to Turning of the Wheel, an intelligent, lively discussion on astrology, art, and adventure. Timing is everything, and as the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed. Join me as I explore the current planetary alignments and offer insights for coping with change. Educational, informative, enlightening, the Turning of the Wheel is a welcome pause in your daily swirl of constant change. Through intelligent discourse, inspired guests, and educational segments, I will help to enlighten your knowledge of astrology and guide you to accept change as the great wheel of life turns. Call in with your questions and speak with some of the greatest visionaries in the time-tested practice of astrology. Turning of the Wheel, Astrology, Art, and Adventure with Chris Flisher, each week on Turning of the Wheel podcast. Hello and welcome to Turning of the Wheel. My name is Chris Flisher. As you know, this is a show about astrology and many other topics that come underneath the metaphysical umbrella, but astrology really is my main focus and my main purpose for the show. I'm entering into my 11th or 12th year doing this. I can't quite remember. I got it down there somewhere. But I am I'm the kind of guy who is doing this, and the podcasts, as you all know, are free. And any of you who can contribute to me via my website, chrisflisher.com or turningofthewheel.com, will be a great help to keep the great wheel turning, as I always say. I want to remind you that I have a newsletter that goes out every week on Sunday afternoon. You can get to that from my website as well, chrisflisher.com or turningofthewheel.com. My podcasts are all available and archived on my website, as well as on iTunes and other podcast outlets. Without further ado, let's get into the show. My guest today is Arielle Guttman. She's a good friend of mine from the West Coast who has lived through the California fires, among other things. And we're going to be talking about what's coming on in the year to come. 2019 is quite a memorable year before it's even gotten here. Those of us who can see these things in the charts know that this is going to be a memorable year simply by virtue of the aspects and what the country's going through as well as the planet. So it's a great honor to have Arielle Guttman on today. Welcome to the show, Arielle. It's good, always good to have you on.
Thank you, Chris. Nice to be here.
Yeah. So, you know, we look at the charts and we see the long-term trends and the big planets and all that, and we see so much activity. I mean, it's just so obvious, especially when you hear talk from other sectors of the world, such as the financial sectors and places like that. And we see this stuff just unfolding exactly as we envisioned it. I find that to be fascinating. And so some of the things that jump out at you, I'm curious what you see that jump out at you in the coming year.
Well, I've been saying this forever. This will be 45 years for me in astrology. And I've been saying throughout the whole time, boy, am I glad I know astrology. Yeah. Otherwise, I don't know how I would make sense of anything that's going on out there. And the times, as you say, I mean, things are bouncing all around. It's crazy. The stock market's bouncing all around, and the planetary energy is pretty fierce right now. Astrologers have, though, for a long time, been coming to a particular point in time. And that particular point in time is the early 2020s when the United States gets its Pluto return. And Pluto takes like 250 years to move around.
So nobody gets to have that experience. Only countries or entities can have that experience.
Exactly. And we've never had it before. But since Pluto went into Capricorn, the sign of the U.S. Pluto, even though the Pluto in the U.S. is at the end of the sign, it's like the minute that Pluto went into the sign in 2008, it started generating all the chaos and the energy of this Pluto return that we're having. And it's just gone, you know, completely crazy right now. And not to mention that Saturn has also come into Capricorn. And that we are now in a place where we have three major things in Capricorn, the South Node, the Pluto, the Saturn. And they're all really in a pretty strong opposition to the United States Sun. And of course, the Sun is the light of the entity, whether it's a person, a country, a thing, you know, whatever it is. The Sun is your vitality, your health, your stamina, your longevity, the light you shine on others. And with all those Capricorn planets opposing it all through all this period, it's a struggle for the country. And we're in a huge tug of war right now. We're opening up 2019 with a government shutdown for How many days has it been now?
It's been 19 as of today, yeah. So we're going to break the record, it looks like, for the longest financial shutdown of the United States.
Okay. And you know, America, yay, yay, we love to break records. Whoever thought we were going to break a record like that?
Yeah,
But,
I know. It's pretty
you
dis
know.
pretty it's pretty disturbing in many ways, and yet we see this. You know, this is, as you say, this is the beauty of astrology. It does give us a language with which to articulate what's going on, and it makes perfect sense. And we saw this coming for quite some time. We didn't really ever know what a Pluto return looked like, but except that we know that Pluto is the planet that sort of destroys and then rebuilds. So we knew that much was happening, and what we see looking outside our windows and on the papers is pretty much that.
Right, and boy, talk about the destroyer and the rebuilder. I'm looking at it from a front row seat, having just gone through living in a town right next door to the campfire, which happened in California recently. And it was right at the week of the Scorpio star point, the new Venus star point moving into Scorpio. You and I have talked about the
Right.
Venus
Yeah, we have.
before. And Venus, I mean, Scorpio is one of the 5 points on the Venus star right now in terms of the wheel of time. So whenever every 4 years when Scorpio does come around, we do get some some major devastation like this. This one was pretty intense. It was a morning star retrograde Venus in Scorpio, and we had the election the week later, and we had the campfire. The good news was the election. And that was the cleaning house, as you could say, that Scorpio does. But the
Right.
campfire came up out of nowhere, absolutely nowhere, and spread like today you're in your house and tomorrow the, and I'm not just saying people's houses were burned. Practically the whole town was destroyed. And I mean, there were 40,000 people in this town. You know, that's a sizable population to be displaced and to be have lost everything. So Pluto, Scorpio, all of these things, obviously, as you said, it tears down and then it rebuilds. So now, as we come into the new year, as I'm talking to some of the people around here, yes, some will rebuild. Some said, okay, that's enough. I'm getting out of here. You know, different people are making different decisions, but that's the one thing that Pluto does help us do. If we've been stuck on something for a long time and we don't really know how to move forward, sometimes it takes an outside force to come our way and just push us through to the other side so that we can pretty clearly see, okay, that is over. It is time to move on now.
And rebuild,
So
yeah.
we love the rebirth of Pluto. We don't necessarily love the destruction of it and the, you know, disappearance of everything we've held near and dear to us, but there's always that rebirth. And
Yeah, it's sort of the paradox of life. You know, life is a dual. We live in a dualistic world, and we are dualistic people. And I think that that is symbolic of the pendulum swinging one way then swinging back. And it's sort of a metaphor for night and day, exactly, in some ways. You know, you have, without the night, you don't have the day. Without the day, you haven't got the night. And they sort of go hand in hand. And I think this sort of tearing down is symbolic of that same sort of theme, whereby out of these ashes, we've rebuilt something better that looks and puts us in a better place, which I do ultimately, at my core, believe will happen.
Yeah, and it does. It always does. I mean, you know, it depends on who you talk to, whether they look at it that way. You know, some people are very bitter and very, and of course, and still in very, very deep grief about the losses. And it's going to take time, definitely take time to heal. But we've all been through it in our lives. We've all been through Pluto transits. We've all lost either somebody near and dear to us or something. And we've all gone through that grieving process, and it does take time. And so I'm going to say that the country right now is in, we haven't come through the other side of the Pluto return. We're still in the dying process. We're still in the deconstruction
Yeah,
phase.
I know.
And as Saturn gets closer to Pluto, which is slated for exactly 1 year from now, I think it's January 2020, we will see an even tighter configuration of the new cycle of Saturn and Pluto and what it is telling us for the next whatever, however long that cycle is. I think it's about Saturn and Pluto. It's about 30-something years, maybe close to 40, between 35 and 40 years, that cycle, because the last time we had Saturn-Pluto was in the early 80s.
Right, I remember very well.
Yeah, that was kind of a trying time too. But, mm-hmm. but you know, back to knowing astrology and being able to see these things pretty clearly, and not being necessarily freaked out about it. It's sort of like, you know, everyone else is freaked out about it and watches, you know, this political circus going on. And of course, when I wrote my piece on the year ahead, 2019, when I was writing it back in really early December, I was looking at these planets, Mars starting the year out in Aries and Saturn in Capricorn and so forth, and the eclipses coming in January and the nodes in Cancer, Capricorn. I thought, well, this is a tug of war. This is like a giant tug of war. Mm-hmm. And of course, who would have dreamed that it would, you know, it can manifest in so many different ways. But here we are with this staunch stand that the president says, we are building a wall and I want the money. And the Congress saying, the leaders of Congress saying, no, you do not get your wall. And what's, you know, who are the victims of this tug of war between them is really the American people.
Yes.
Who at this point are not getting paid for their work. And who knows, you know, how far this can go. But I think that really this is part of the Mars and Aries too, the square.
Right. Yeah, it's absolutely right.
The tension between Capricorn and Aries, because Mars is Aries is in Mars. And that's another thing I wanted to mention is that we have right now, we have four planets
in the signs that they rule. Yeah. You got Jupiter and Sagittarius. Yeah, no, it's amazing. And so they're all extra, all of those attributes of those planets that they represent, I think, are actually emphasized and highlighted and sort of emboldened in some regard.
Right. They are definitely highlighted and emboldened. And I think someone asked me this, you know, like yesterday, well, what do you think that means with all these planets in their own signs? I think it means that when planets are in their own signs, there's a certain feeling of entitlement, mm-hmm. and there's a certain feeling of, I can do whatever I want. I'm in my own place. And so when those planets are challenged by other planets in their own signs, it's sort of like everybody wants their way, and it's going to be very hard to give in.
Yeah, and they can't all be in the spotlight together.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. And there's nothing in Libra right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, there's the asteroid Pallas Athena is, and she is good as a peacemaker and the goddess of justice and strategy, but she's also a goddess of war. And, you know, right now, without any major planets in Libra and all this other stuff in planets in their own signs, I'm really feeling, of course, Mars will only be there for the first, like, what,
six weeks.
Of the
yeah,
year.
Yeah.
But still, you've got this force field of tug of war energy that everybody's saying, my way. No, it's going to be the way I want it. And there's not compromise. There's not the ability to really sit down at the table and negotiate. So something has got to break this. I think it's going to take another crisis of some sort to break this stalemate.
Well, we're in a crisis, if you think about it. I mean, I think you mean on a global level. You need something along those lines that would sort of shake
yes.
it up. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Maybe an intervention from outside.
Yeah,
maybe.
I could see that.
Yeah.
Some sort of natural disaster that forces us to pay attention. I think this is the sort of the collective. I think the environment is the collective problem for all of us in the planet. And so we all have to sort of deal with this. This is our sort of come to Jesus moment where we have to respond to this in some way. And if we don't respond to it, the earth will respond to us.
Mm-hmm. It already is.
Yeah,
and as
it is.
I was watching the fire, the smoke, billowing smoke, which actually went all the way to the Bay Area and covered the Bay Area for like 2 weeks in thick, maybe more. and thick black smoke until the rain started coming. And everybody had games canceled, schools canceled, all outdoor activities canceled. And of course, in California, everybody's outdoors all the time, running and jogging and playing and hiking and doing bicycle riding and doing everything, you know? And so they were not, this was not an easy thing for them either to endure. You know, the quality of air. And I remember 3 or 4 days in a row, the news people were saying, the air quality in the Bay Area right now is worse than the air quality in Beijing.
That's incredible. Wow.
You know, and people were wearing masks. And so you feel like you're sitting really on the precipice of this global warming issue that you're talking about right now. And but don't you also, Chris, feel like the time for that is now to address it with Uranus moving into Taurus for the next
of
7 years?
Of course I do. And I think what frustrates me, and I think it will happen, to be honest. I think we will be forced to do it. What bothers me the most about that is how slow the process is and how counter the administration is to taking steps towards it. This is what frustrates me. But I think this could all change within the next election, the next big election. That all could change.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and I think the new people in Congress and just the wave of disasters we're seeing take place is going to kind of push it to a crisis point over the, it's already at a crisis point, but until it hits people right in their own front yard.
Well, I think it's going to hit in California. I mean, we've already been told that they're going to withhold FEMA money from that area as sort of I think it's a political punishment or political hand slapping. But your new governor is a very progressive governor. I've seen him many times on TV. He's a brilliant guy. I've got great faith in his ability to sort of push back just the way Jerry Brown did.
Gavin Newsom, he's really good. He's very well liked. Well, we'll see. His moon is in Capricorn, middle degrees of Capricorn. And so his coming into office immediately is going to, he's going to have a handful on his, you know, he's going to have the weight of the world on his shoulders to try to deal with some of these problems and issues. But I was looking, I don't know how much your listeners want to hear this. It doesn't, might not apply to them, but I was looking at the chart for California statehood. And, but you might be interested to know that it is going through its own amazing transformation right now. It's in the middle of a Uranus return, and Uranus
takes 84 years.
Uranus in the chart of California is 29 degrees and 50 minutes of Aries.
Oh my gosh.
So right on the cusp of Aries Taurus, where Uranus is right now.
Yeah.
But guess what? Pluto is also at 29 Aries in California's chart. It was born in 1850 when it became a state officially, and that was a Uranus Pluto conjunction.
Yep.
And it's angular in the chart. It's like really close to the angles. And I was looking at that thinking Uranus and Pluto conjunct in the chart of California. Well, when we think of Uranus and Pluto, of course we all flash back to the 60s, because that's when we had it. Our lives.
Yeah.
And that's when the whole world was turning upside down. But that's when California became sort of California was like on the map for being the frontier, the leading edge of that movement.
Yep. The flower generation was really centered around Haight-Ashbury and from there on. Yeah.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So I haven't looked at this totally at every Uranus return that California's had since 1850. It hasn't had that many, but because it takes so long to return. But it's having one now, and Pluto's creeping up onto it, too. So, but the thing I thought about that is that California's always been the state that's the innovator. It's on the leading edge. Mm-hmm. Things start here, and then they go to the rest of the country and then the rest of the world. And think of technology with the Uranian.
Silicon Valley, yeah, it's a huge place for that, all that birth, yeah.
And all of that, you know, all the trends, all of the, you know, the Hollywood trends, the technology trends, even the building things, you know, the innovative solar energies and wind power and solar power and all those things are, you know, there's wind farms up and down the state. Harvesting the wind right now. and you know, trying to convert the old system into the new system. Now, of course, we still have lots of cars and lots of
traffic jams.
But
you also have an air quality standard. You have an air quality standard.
Every parking lot I go to has a charging station with, you know, it's like every parking lot. What I love about it is you can go even hiking in the woods and you see these little areas to pull up. And there's these little charging stations for the cars. So we are going to be converting, and very soon.
And I think the idea
to a non-petroleum-based economy.
California's always been on the leading edge as far as air quality and cars. They have special rules that are for emissions and stuff. And they are really, because of such a, you are such a large populace and you take up so much space and you have a very strong voting block, you have great weight, you have great power at your disposal. One of the things I could see changing with the California going forward would be the requirement, or at least the suggestion, that they alter the number of senators per state, or they base the number of senators per state on population rather than on geography. So why does North Dakota have two senators and California has two senators when there's probably less than a million people in North Dakota and California's got 40 million people? I mean, it's just it's not equal representation there.
Right, or the state that I lived in for almost 30 years, New Mexico. We're one of the smallest states in population, and you could say the same thing applies
there. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You know, it has to be based on population size, and I could see that. And I could also see the whole idea of California leading the charge toward, like you said, more of green energy initiatives and ways around trying to solve these problems. I know Elon Musk is trying to build a tube train from San Francisco to Los Angeles, high-speed train. So these are all things that are very progressive and can be done, and I think California could easily lead the way. But there are challenges in that. Yeah. There's no question.
By the way, Elon Musk, I looked at his chart in comparison to Nikola Tesla.
Oh, yeah.
And there are so many connections, you wouldn't believe.
That doesn't surprise me in the least. Yeah, really doesn't surprise me at all.
They're both cancers, by the way.
Interesting.
They're both cancer sons, you know. Oh, and the one more thing I'll say about California's chart, which I think everybody can relate to, is it has Neptune natally in Pisces.
Oh, yeah.
And of course, Neptune's also in Pisces right now, but so it's also recently had a Neptune return. Hmm. It's now having a Uranus return.
That
so
explains the Hollywood aspect, I think, very clearly.
That's the Hollywood, vibe, which, you know, Neptune. So that's the power, really, when you think about it, Neptune in its own sign. And since the Neptune and Pisces return, even before that, there were, I mean, you think of all these animated studios and Pixar, all these films that are coming out now that are the technology involved, the animation, the CGI, just the amazing effects that you see in these films. And again, all kind of manufactured here and created and innovative ways that laboratories right here in this state. So I could talk about the chart forever, but we should probably move on to something else.
Well, you know, but I mean, I think that you've raised some interesting points, especially with regard to where we see things going. I think the idea of these four planets, well, at least the three outer planets, Neptune, Jupiter, and Saturn, being in their own, in the signs that they rule, it gives them they're chomping at the bit for the same airway. They kind of want to say, no, it's my turn. And the other one says, no, it's my turn. It's my turn. And I wonder if they're in that drive to be heard, metaphorically speaking, if there isn't something that comes out of there where they all get, you know, 15 minutes of fame or whatever you want, for lack of a better term, where they have an opportunity to shine for a period of time. And the interesting thing is that when we see it going into 2020, when Jupiter comes into Capricorn as well, I think that provides, it's going to amplify the whole conversation about what is being torn down and how it's being reconstructed. It's going to amplify it. I also tend to think, being an optimist myself, that that's going to be there's going to be some goodness in that reconstruction due to the presence of Jupiter. I'm wondering how you feel about that.
Yeah, I think Jupiter definitely will make a difference. But on your point to Jupiter, I think even though we're looking at this, you know, the situation we're faced in is the Capricorn Aries and Cancer squares right now, but really What's also happening is Jupiter in Sag in its own sign, square Neptune in Pisces in its own sign. And I think what it comes down to is a real philosophical, or let's say belief system. Trump believes in the wall. That's right. His belief system. That's where he's going. He can't see anything else. That's the only thing he can see. And when we are so attached to our beliefs, we can't see anything else. And of course, the Democrats, led by the current leaders, are basically, no, you're not having a wall. And it's like when they're dialoguing with each other, we don't really get to go behind the scenes to see, you know, like to ask him, why are you so stuck on that one way? Or ask the Democrats, why are you so stuck on saying no? Where can we find a common ground? But again, it's these two planets and these two signs just going, no, this is my belief. I'm having my way.
Well, you know, I think it's representative of the idea of Jupiter being the guy with the wall. Let's just play this out metaphorically. Jupiter being the guy with the wall saying, I want to expand. I want this big, bold wall. It's going to cost a lot of money. And the other side of the coin with Neptune would be, this is an immoral priority that you're pushing. We are not a nation of walls and doors. We're a nation of open arms. I mean, lend me your tired. This is the credo on the Statue of Liberty. This is what our whole country is founded on. So I see that as being a conflict, too. That's where the square is really coming into manifestation. I think it's that sort of opposing ideas.
That's a great point, because who was it I heard say, I don't know if it was an astrologer or someone in the news, but it was like, we are not going to be known as a nation that whose main monument is a wall separating us. We are, our main monument is the Statue of Liberty.
It's the Statue of Liberty. Yeah, it's the Statue of Liberty.
And that's your Neptune, what you're talking about, your Neptunian, the ideal of, we are a nation of immigrants. Come on.
And the thing is, the other premise that is also spouted all the time is, let's go back to a time when things were great. You know, you and I both know that time just never goes backwards. You're never going to get back to that time again. That was a moment in time based on the aspects of the time, the people of the time, the where we were as evolutionary beings and the history of the world. We're not going to go back and retread that. I don't want to go back to 1952 and the medicine was terrible. I don't want to go back when we didn't have the internet. And so I know that I'm speaking in terms of physical things that we're obviously not going to go back. But even as a theme, we're not going to go back. We can't go back. That's one of the biggest ironies of it. We all know time is a corkscrew. It's always turning, always going forward. And that's just how it is. We're never going to go back.
Yeah, and when I do go back to look at past transits of things, I'm kind of reminded, well, maybe things were never that great. We have this sort of nostalgia about, oh, it was so good back when. But then if you really look at the reality of things, it's like, no, there have been problems all the way along.
I know. So, and I guess it depends upon your definition of what the time was. I think this all refers back to a period of time based on his age. The 1950s, post-World War II, was a great time for America because we came back from a war. Everybody needed cars and jobs. Everybody was employed. So, yes, that was a wonderful time. But we also had racism. We had sexism that was rampant back then. Women, it was just not at all very progressive, and look at how far we've come. I know that time, I know that evolution is a very slow moving train, and it does take time to get there. But I mean, come on, we don't need to go back to that time.
Well, you're right. I mean, even in my Venus star point research, when I looked at the historical trends, it showed how, and we grew up then in the 50s, it showed how in the 50s, the 40s and the 50s, post World War II, the Venus star point was actually affecting the United States in the best possible way, maybe in the history of the entire nation. In terms of, yes, it's lending people its resources, it's helping to rebuild, it's economically stable, and people had jobs. And yeah, there were other problems. There was still segregation, and there was still a lot of that had to break open in the 60s. And civil rights, women's rights, gay rights, all those things that came up in the 60s, which, by the way, we're revisiting again with Chiron going into Aries right now, because this is the 50-year return of Chiron in Aries. And guess when it was in Aries before? It was the late 60s, 1968.
A lot of parallels there. You're right about that. We're going to take a quick break here. My guest today is Arielle Guttman. She's a wonderful astrologer out of California. She's best known for her book, The Venus Star Rising. Her website is sophiavenus.com. That's S-O-P-H-I-A, venus.com. She's got all of her newsletters archived up there, and she's wonderful. I highly recommend her book. It's a whole new take on sort of cosmology. It has a whole new different approach of it, but it's incredibly accurate and very insightful. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back in about 2.5 minutes. I encourage you to look at her website, and while you're out on the web looking around, stop by my place, chrisflisher.com or turningthewheel.com, and help support this show and keep this great wheel turning. We'll be back in a few minutes. Hang in there.
What is your destiny? Where are you going? What is your real purpose? Do you know? Do you want to know? Of course you do. It's your duty to yourself. We are all here for a reason, and we all have great potential. Discover all of this and more with a professional astrology reading. My name is Chris Flisher, and I can help you. Discover your strengths and work on your weaknesses, and live your life to its fullest capacity. Based on your birthday, birthplace, and birth time, an authentic astrology reading will allow you to live your life to the fullest and reveal your true purpose. Only real astrology can give you real information. It is your destiny, and it is your path. Write me at chris@chrisflisher.com and book a reading today. Or call me at 978-393-1036. That's 978-393-1036. www.chrisflisher.com.
Astrology is the science of spirit, and it can serve as an invaluable aid in making the difficult choices in life and seeking truth in all the directions we choose. It holds the potential to allow each of us to evolve to our highest potential. It is the logic of the universe, the code of existence, and the pathway to true wisdom. It is our duty to draw from it the instructions for our lives and to live them to our fullest potential. As the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed.
Hi, your host, Chris Flisher here. I've been producer and host of this podcast and radio show for the past 10 years. My goal has always been to provide enlightening, progressive, and logical discussions about where we are as a species and how we move ourselves further down the road towards our greater potential. I believe astrology provides a great tool for observing our progress and awakening our consciousness to becoming a whole, better, and more complete individuals. I have sought to invite the best contemporary guests, thought leaders, and progressive minds to discuss topics that concern us all, regardless of your beliefs. Consider making a contribution through PayPal to help keep the great wheel turning so that I can continue for the next 10 years along the same enlightened path. As always, I thank you for your support. Okay, welcome back to Turning of the Wheel. Our guest today is Arielle Guttman. Her book is The Venus Star Rising. But today we're talking about the highlights of 2019 in particular, because it's a very, very unusual year with regard to where we have our planets placed and what we see down the road. And of course, as we left the show before the break, we were talking about Chiron and Aries. And that was 50 years ago. So we're coming back to a time when we had this wonderful burst of creative energy, the 1960s. I lived it and loved it every minute. I actually thought back then that we had actually, I thought humankind, mankind, whatever humankind, the species, had stumbled on the right formula, because I love the idea there was a sense of love, there was a sense of peace, there was a sense of community. I lived in a commune for many years back there. I had hair down to the middle of my back. I was a long-haired hippie like everybody read about, everybody sees. And I really thought back then, and maybe I was naive in some regard, but I really thought that we had stumbled upon the right way to live. And yet, here we are 50 years later, and we're still struggling with so many of these issues. I mean, the idea of, you know, the hatred and racism and this stuff, it just galls me. I'm just wondering if this could be a signal of a time. I mean, Chiron is the wounded healer. Is this the time we revisit those themes again, do you think?
Yes, it is the wounded healer. And what's interesting about it, it's starting the year off with, at the end of Pisces, early Aries, with Mars there, and also the asteroid Hygieia, which is the goddess of healing. And the three of them are all sort of lined up at the Aries point, the world point. And so I think Chiron going into early Aries, it's the beginning of Chiron's 50-year, what we might call hero's journey around the zodiac. It begins now. And because Aries and even Mars, but let's say just Aries, it's the start of the cycle. Aries is like the young warrior, the young hero. If you think of the hero's journey that is talked about with mythology, and especially Joseph Campbell talked about it.
Right, a lot.
And you think back to that time, and what was the hero's journey at that point with Mars, with Chiron and Aries? The Vietnam War was raging during that time, and I think Chiron's cry through Aries, because it's a young sign, it's a new sign, the world was turning upside down and expressing itself really through the youth of the era. And the cry of adolescents and young adults was loud. It was very loud. And I think what's so unique about that time, really more than any other time that we've encountered since or maybe before in history, outstandingly unique, is that the protests or the anti-war movement, the cry of the people of the country wanting to stop the war, actually succeeded in stopping the war.
It did. Mm-hmm.
And when have we ever had that kind of success with the people versus the establishment since then?
Well, we had a taste of it after the election. We had the Women's March, and I think that's an incredibly strong movement. I do believe we are headed towards a more matriarchal hierarchy. I think that's going to unfold over the next several years. And I think that was a pivotal point starting that. But you're right. That required outrage in order to get people onto the streets. And I think if more stuff may be coming that we haven't seen yet, obviously, that may spark that same outrage that gets people into the streets, because that's where it has to happen. You're right.
Mm-hmm. And it's funny because of all the other wars, I mean, this did not happen for Iraq or Afghanistan, even though there were marches around that and there were marches around other wars, too, and protests about it because, you know, so many of us that live in this country are pretty much anti-war, unless you're absolutely in need of defending yourself and your attack. But to just go out and attack another country, no.
No, I know. I think a large part of the reason for the outrage back then, too, was the draft. I mean, I was a member. I was in the draft, and I had a number. I was in the draft lottery, and that's what fueled a lot of people. Anger, and was the fact that their sons and daughters were getting drafted for a war that was illegal and immoral. And that
right.
Also. So then now we have a volunteer army, which is different, I suppose. But we the taxpayers, are still paying for something. Nothing makes me more angry than to know that what little money I make, I've got to give to the government to help support these wars. I don't like that. That really, really annoys me.
Mm-hmm. Or the fact that most of us as tax-paying citizens of the U.S., knowing that our taxes are going to fund the military operations. And when you look at the budget of the U.S. military, it's, what is it, 100 times more than any other agency or all the agencies combined?
And in the world as well. We have the largest military budget, I think, of any place in the world. It's so one-sided, it's ridiculous. It's pathetic. Mm-hmm. It's glaring.
And that's the side of the United States being a cancer country that basically is so powerful yet feels so insecure. Mm-hmm. And has to just guard itself and want to build up a military presence everywhere and want to build a wall at the southern border. And it's like afraid of its own shadow.
Yeah.
So, is that a nation? Is that who we are? As a people?
Well, we kind of got a taste of power, and I think it drove us to intervene in ways, and it got perverted somehow because of the lessons that were learned in other wars, and the idea of the domino theory and the idea of trickle-down economy and all these highfalutin ideas that the politicians try to spin on us really don't hold much water in the long run. And I think the only thing I really agree upon, and this is unusual for me with this guy in the White House, is the fact that he doesn't like the idea of us being the world's policeman. I agree with that concept, but we are that person, and we can't just turn our backs on it. We've got to do it very gradually and do it with allegiances and support from other countries. That's the only thing I think that will work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I went to a conference a couple of years ago in Berkeley that was hosting at UC Berkeley, right where the student demonstrations were in the 60s. And it was an organization called Veterans for Peace. Mm-hmm. And it happened to be there, and I just decided to attend to see what's this all about. Okay, I've never been to a veterans thing or really connected to the military in any other way except, you know, certain friends and clients and associates I've had that have been, but it didn't hit my family personally, okay, my close circle back then, as far as going to war. But of course, most of the people, this could be veterans of any war,
right?
But Veterans for Peace. And they were mostly from Vietnam, as you can imagine, Vietnam War veterans. So, but what was interesting was this group of people who actually had been on the front line somewhere and saw the devastation and actually saw the lies they were being told and really didn't understand what they were really fighting about and came back and just turned so against war. And now they're all cooperating with, you know, peacekeeping movements all around the world and so forth. And I thought, this is really interesting because with Chiron coming back to Aries now, remember when the Vietnam soldiers came back to America, they weren't necessarily welcomed.
They were not welcomed at all. They were not welcomed because so many people were against the war, and they associated them falsely with the war as if they were the ones causing the war. They simply were victims.
They were victims. They had no choice. They were probably economically in situations where they could not afford to either go to college to get out of the draft or any other situation that would keep them at home. And so some of them went willingly, of course, but others were, you know, went against their will, and they were not treated as heroes. And I think about Chiron and Aries as the warrior, the young hero, the wounded warrior returning back from Vietnam, and all these years it's taken to get them really, they came back not only traumatized by war, but so displaced from the whole, where do I fit in now? How do I fit into society here? And so I'm thinking that this Chiron in Aries, where are the young warriors now? Where are the wounded warriors now as we come into the next few years with Chiron in early Aries? And how are they going to show up? And I'm just really curious to see how that presents itself.
Yeah, well, you know, it would obviously fall on the millennials and the generation beyond, the next generation that came beyond that. They're the ones that are feeling the pinch. They're the ones, I think, that, you know, I think it's the college graduates, one of which is my son, who's 26, he's going to be 27, actually, this Saturday. He's a Capricorn. It's his generation who has this enormous student debt, and yet he works in a bookstore. Now, nothing wrong with working in a bookstore. I'm sure he likes it, but before that, he worked in a hardware store. But he trained for something completely different that was much more satisfying. It's that kind of person who's going to say, I spent all this money on a college education and I can't get a job in a college in an appropriate field because of the economy and because of the nature of the student debt. So you're saddled with this student debt and you can't get the job to overcome it. And that's part of the problem. That will fuel perhaps the anger that gets the people out of complacency and on the streets, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that student debt thing, I mean, that was a big issue a couple of years ago. We haven't heard about that lately.
Oh, it's still sitting out there, believe me. It's going to come to home to roost at some point in time, because I know that people can't, you can't work in a coffee shop or a Starbucks and pay off your student loans. You just can't do that.
Well, and I think with Chiron coming back to Aries, this is how it's going to show up again. The young heroes who paid an enormous amount of money, can't get jobs, still owe that debt. So I think we're going to have another whole generation of young wounded warriors who are young heroes, let's say, wounded heroes. Chiron wasn't just a wounded warrior, healer. He was a healer first and foremost. The fact that so many people make so much of the wound, I've always, you know, had a question about, like, let's not make that the first thing you notice about.
I think the reason that association is there is because inherent in being wounded, knowing the effects of being wounded makes you more empathetic because you understand the pain involved. Perhaps that's the best way to look at it.
Yeah, so then you could say the empathetic and compassionate healer also. But this is a place where I think the young, and I do think it's the youth again. You know, in the 60s, it was the youth that changed things for the world and got it, catalyzed it, I'd say. Maybe not changed things, but got, you know, they were the catalysts that got it going. And I think, again, it will be the youth. I mean, who listens to older people anyway? But the youth are the ones, the vibrant. They represent our future. They're the ones that have to come together and say, no, this is not the world we want. This is what we do want.
Yeah. And it's their world. It's their time in the sun. So they have to rise to the occasion. They really have no choice.
Yeah. And so I'm actually, for the first time, really in a long time, very encouraged by the youth and their feeling of, and maybe these are the Pluto and Scorpio kids. I don't know.
I think it is the Pluto and Scorpio kids. I do believe that's it. Because that would form a sextile to transiting Pluto, and it would be a bridge that makes that all happen correctly in a progressive manner.
Exactly. So these Pluto and Scorpio going into Pluto and Sagittarius kids that are coming of age now, they're, and you think about Sagittarius too, they're the torchbearers of the, you know, they're the wave, you know, that I think of carrying the light to the next, you know, shooting the arrow. Yeah, Sag, but I also think of it more as almost, I think of Sag as just as much of a Promethean type of an energy as I do Uranus and Aquarius, which I know Rick Tarnas talks about. Uranus is the carrier of Prometheus, and I agree with that. But sometimes I think that very noble side of Sagittarius, not the side where they get on their high horse, but the side, well, they can get on their high horse, but for reasons of humanitarian purposes.
It's got a deeply spiritual quality to it as well. So there's a real sort of moral fiber to it, a sort of value fiber to it, that I think humanitarianly comes across very well. And I think that's it's sort of an adventurous and expansive and a sort of progressive evolutionary type of philosophy and thought pattern.
Right, exactly. So interesting, because we have so many new things happening in the next few years. It's sort of like we're on a giant reset button right now. We're finishing out a very old cycle. In my research with the Venus star point has one of the predictions that I made, I think in the UAC presentation on the transits of Venus, was that our oil-based economy began when the Scorpio star point began in the 20s, then in the 1920s. 1926 was the first Scorpio star point. And 2026 is the last Scorpio star point, because they last about 100 years through a sign, the slow-moving star of Venus. As it goes through five signs at any given time, but one of the points on that five-point star has been Scorpio. And I saw a picture from the late 20s on the internet somewhere where this woman, actually, modern-looking woman, was standing next to her new car. And this car and this modern woman were both something very, very revolutionary at the time. And I'm thinking, okay, where are we 100 years later? But that's really when you look back at the petroleum industry and the oil-based industry to fuel these vehicles. So it's ending in 2026, and we're already in the process of trying to convert that to things powered by air, things powered by the sun, things powered by electricity, et cetera, all of these things. And I really feel like it is the end of the era. The mid-20s is going to be the end of the era for the petroleum-based world. And everybody that depends on that as their livelihood or is connected to it in a big way is going to probably have to wake up and smell the roses ahead of time. And do something.
And yet we're seeing like, and yet we're headed the opposite direction in some ways, where we're trying to bring back coal energy. We're opening up our some of the national parks and protected lands for drilling to sort of continue this trend. But I think we know that there's some gain loss there because of what it's doing to the environment, the cost, and the damage that it goes along with it. And I think it was Richard Nixon that actually put the economy of the United States onto an oil-based economy instead of being on a gold-based economy. And
yes, the dollar.
The dollar, yeah, exactly right. So, I think that this idea is spot on. I think the people were going to come. This is what's interesting about California. They really are leading the charge when it comes to this. And we see more hybrid cars these days, more electric cars. I think this is going to happen. And I think it's actually one of the nicest things about it, in what people don't seem to understand, at least one person in the White House doesn't seem to understand that, is that this generates an enormous amount of jobs for people. This is a whole new sector we have not tapped into, really. The whole solar industry, wind industry are huge growth areas for jobs, which would really help the economy instead of going back to the old damn coal.
Well, Obama was talking about that in his election campaigns and his State of the Union addresses, all in the early days of Obama. He was talking about how America could become, quote unquote, great again by fueling those new types of industries and putting so many people at work and making us leaders in the world for the new. I mean, that was a visionary type of thing he was proposing.
And yet we're giving it up right now. We're totally going the opposite direction. We're giving all that away.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and the thing I realized, too, was the Jupiter-Neptune square that we're having right now, which is this, battle over, what do you believe? What do I believe? And what's the best way to do it? It's a third quarter square. And so in a third quarter square, you always look back at the inception of the cycle, which was actually in 2009. Jupiter and Neptune were conjunct in 2009 in late Aquarius. And Obama had just come into office, and there was a sign of hope. He campaigned on hope. There was still a feeling of hope, and he was crafting at that time the Affordable Care Act, right, which went into law in 2010, I think. But that was the beginning of the Jupiter Neptune cycle we're in now. And I find it interesting at the third quarter that they want to trash the Affordable Care Act that came in then, and all the ideas and visions that he had for where our future was going are also up for, definite challenge at this point. Are they going to succeed or are they not going to succeed?
Yeah, and that's another interesting point about that was back at that time when they were conjunct, Neptune and Jupiter were conjunct, we also had the financial crisis, which is called the Great Recession. And if we bring that forward, we look at the times where we are now with the stock markets going wild and with tariffs being imposed and people being laid off or furloughed at government workers, an enormous financial crisis could very well be looming despite what the politicians and the economists say. I think you and I recognize that there's an economical crisis probably in the waiting.
Yeah. That's another reset button that's about to happen. And I'm not, I can't say from experience that I've ever really been, that I know that much about the way the financial markets work.
Nor do I. But I just think that it's evident there.
But there are signs based on these things that we've talked about today that definitely there's something going on. And of course, when I say these things, it winds up scaring people and making them go, oh, but what do I do now? What do I invest in now or whatever, And it's all, people are always thinking about that. We're coming back to home. Where's it going to hit me at home? How's it going to hit me at home? And I think, really, I've always said that what you have in the stock market, what it's worth is only based on a piece of, not even anymore a piece of paper, but you don't even get the paper. You get a number on the computer saying this is what it's worth, okay? Mm-hmm. Or you may get the printed form saying this is what it's worth. But unless you've got the cash in hand, or the same thing with property values, this is what my house is worth. But unless you actually have the cash in hand and you sell it at that moment, then it's really speculative about what it's worth. So it's all kind of this big game,
It's all based on emotion, speculation, and what you anticipate happening and trying to be ahead of the game, but that's a difficult game to play, especially when so much as there's so many variables involved across the globe.
Yes, exactly. There's too many variables here. And one thing I've noticed recently, I mean, the planets are still the planets and they still have their cycles and they still say what they're going to say and they work in a certain way. But I have been getting the feeling really for about the last decade or so, maybe even longer than that, that there's so much manipulation going on behind the scenes of things right now that are controlling things, that are not allowing things to happen naturally, the natural flow of the economic waves, let's say. The stock markets, for instance, I know they're all generated by computers now and algorithms. And I also know that even the housing prices are based on certain factors that are not really based on reality, but they're based on whether somebody behind the scenes thinks, okay, we need a shot in the economy now. Now we're going to lower it. Gas prices are going to go up. Gas prices are going to go down. Housing prices up, housing prices down. So we're all victims of this constant roller coaster ride of what's, and I think we just have to invest with what feels good to us, what feels safe to us. I think people are always going to need places to live. That's a given. So investing in a home or land or property, especially places where you can grow your own food in the face right. of all changing dynamics around how the food is produced and all of that. But
I've told my clients to invest in cannabis stocks because they're obviously eventually this country is going to be legal from coast to coast and it's going to be a great area to invest in. I think it's already shown that signs in all the states that have been legalized.
Yeah. That's true. At first, I thought you said Canada okay. stocks.
Well, cannabis. Well, Canada is leading the charge with cannabis.
What's going on in Canada that I don't know about? Okay.
Well, they legalized it, so they're one of the few countries on the planet that has legalized it, as well as South. I think it was South Korea did, or was it the Philippines? I'm not sure. One country maybe I'm not sure which country it is. I'm going to misquote this, so don't anybody listening quote me on this. But if you Google up, say Asia Pacific Rim legalized marijuana, you'll find the country. I'm pretty sure it's in the area. There's another country that legalized it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the states that have already legalized it have seen, you know, how tremendously what a shot in the arm it has been for their economies and for their schools and their infrastructures and everything that the revenues they're getting from that are there just wouldn't happen any other way.
And the biggest hurdles they face are the federal restrictions on the banking of that money, because that's what's holding them all back in some ways. They can't put that money anyplace, so it's kind of like they're storing it in warehouses as cash or whatever. Here in Massachusetts, they do allow you to use a debit card, but so that at least involves the bank in some capacity.
Okay. So. Yeah, I think I've used debit cards for that as well.
Yeah. So it's we're fortunate. See, we're fortunate, you and I, because we live on either end of the country where we have progressive societies that have seen the value in this. We've just become legal. I mean, the stores have just opened here within the last several months, even though we voted it in 2016. They certainly dragged their feet getting there, but once it's here, it's here. And I think it's a growth industry that will help people in some ways. And it's a natural product that grows out of the planet Earth. I mean, how can you make something like that illegal? I mean, it's just absurd. But that's another whole subject for the different.
Well, place. It's because they classified it as a drug. It's not a drug. Plant. It's medicine. It's a plant and it's medicine. And there are so many studies that prove how effective it is for pain. And that's why those of us in the aging population, I mean, when I was living, when I first moved back to Northern California a few years ago, I was taking care of my mother, and there were all these programs at the senior center that she attended. And one of them was about medical marijuana. And they said that the fastest growing market for cannabis in the country right now was the seniors, the aging population, because they were seeing that, for one thing, even though it's still somewhat costly, it's way cheaper than pharmaceutical drugs, and it's way more effective for pain.
Yeah.
So,
as any number of things get solved by that problem. How did your mother feel about that? Did she ever discuss that with you?
I never. Well, she was in her 90s at the time, and she. She had all kinds of aches and pains, and I actually talked to the rest of my family about it. I said, I don't want to do this without your permission, but nothing seems to be working for her leg pain. And so I bought some those salves, those creams, those pain
yep.
relief creams.
Mm-hmm.
And we rubbed it on her legs 2-3 times a day. And I never really asked her much about it. And then one day I remember saying, Mom, you're not grabbing your legs anymore in pain. How have they been feeling lately? And she goes, oh, they're okay. Hmm. And I thought, well, before that medication, she was, you know, you could see she was in pain. She
yeah,
was just grimacing
yeah.
in pain all the time and grabbing her legs and trying to rub them and trying to get rid of the pain. And I thought, wow, this is amazing. You know, mm-hmm. there it is in action.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know from that generation, there's always a stigma attached with it. And that's what I was wondering about her opinions in that. Did she actually know where the stuff came from?
She didn't know it was that kind of cream. It was CBD. I don't think it was it isn't the stuff that gets you high. It's not
right.
the THC.
Right, right, okay.
There's so many CBD products now that that are out there on the market in lots of stores.
Oh, I know. I know.
That so we used that. So it wasn't a problem for her, but we didn't tell her what it was. I just said, I had this cream. You know, we're going to try this new cream.
Yeah, good for you. Well, you know, I think it's the wave of the future. I think it's, I never thought I'd see it in my lifetime. I'm happy it's here. I think it's going to be a step in the right direction. I think it's a way of opening people's minds and helping them, letting them see the world through different eyes and very progressive eyes as well. So I'm encouraged. Mm-hmm. I'm encouraged by that. As we look forward to, we're just about out of time here. But as I look forward to the year, I think that in summary, I would say that I'm optimistic. I think change is always a good thing, even though it's difficult to go through. It's not till you come out the other end of it that you realize, wow, it really was worth it. I do think that it will be worth it, but I think it's a long, muddy walk through deep quicksand to get there. It's going to take a hard time to get there, but I think we will get there. And hopefully we'll get there in our lifetime, be able to see the fruits of the hard work it took to get there. It's a very complex world we live in, and a lot of variables involved, but I do think we're going to get there. And just, do you have a parting thoughts in that regard?
Yeah, exactly. My tagline for this year, well, I had two of them, but one of them was feet on the ground, eyes on the stars. Because of Jupiter and Sag, I think we're going to get a little boost of kind of adrenaline mm-hmm. energy, high adrenaline energy that's going to make us feel more hopeful and that we are really making progress somewhere along the line. Whereas last year it was just totally, everything was retrograde and heavy and hard and slow and difficult. I think this year we still have some of those difficulties, but we have Jupiter kind of bringing the light ahead. And the other one is finding joy in the mundane. I think we have to really stick to what we're doing and pay attention closely to, you know, what we're working on, and maybe working a little harder than we've been working and tightening the money belt a little, budgeting better, but finding joy in our everyday lives. It's like, don't do something that makes you feel miserable. Be doing something that really makes you feel happy.
That's right. It's a good counterbalance. It's a good sort of antidote to the difficult angles. And I think the three planets that are in the signs that they rule are just going to have to vie for attention, and I think perhaps the one who's needed at the time will step in and fill the role is what I think will happen. So when the hard work is required, Saturn will be there. When we need to deepen our sense of spirituality and psychology and sort of how we view the world, Neptune will be there. When we want to expand, Jupiter will be there. So we have much to be thankful for. Yeah. So
exactly.
Well, that's great having you on today. My guest today has been Arielle Guttman. She's the author of Venus Star Rising, which is a fascinating book. Really gives you quite a bit of insight into where how Venus plays a role in your life, especially based on your time of birth and where your Venus star point was at that time, you'll be amazed at the planets in your own personal chart and how they line up with the Venus star points of your era. I encourage you to do that. Ariel's website is sophiavenus.com. That's SOPHIA Venus.com. I encourage you to check out her archives and her and follow her on Facebook and all the other things. And you can also follow me on Facebook. I'm not there too often these days because it's just such a huge time sink. But I have a presence there. My newsletter gets posted there. I post my podcast there. I'm also on YouTube. I'm on Twitter. All those darn social media places we have to be on these days, I'm there. So I encourage you to check that out too. But anyway, Arielle Guttman, SophiaVenus.com is your website. Arielle, it's always fun to talk to you. And thank you so much for coming on today.
Loved it, Chris. I always have a good time when when we're chatting together on this show. We have such great topics to discuss.
Yeah, and we have a good synergy between us, which is
so great. Thank you for, and I want to reiterate to your audience, support these shows, these podcasts. We learn a lot from them. You can't imagine what kind of hard work it takes to show up every week and do what Chris is doing. And so even if you can only give a few dollars a week, or something, or a few dollars a month. Try to support all of our astrologers. You know, none of the astrologers these days are getting paid that much for the huge amount of efforts that they're putting out to try to educate and enlighten the world with the hard studies we've done and the work we've put into it all these years. So again, I want to say thank you to Chris.
And, oh, that's great, Arielle. Thank you very much for that. I appreciate that. Okay, mm-hmm. Well, we'll see you again. We will meet in the stars somewhere once again. Take care. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.
You've been listening to Turning of the Wheel with your host, Chris Flisher. To schedule a reading with me or to order artwork, you may visit my website at www.turningofthewheel.com. That's www.turningofthewheel.com. Or you can call me at 978-393-1036. Thank you. And as always, be open to possibilities.